Yes, I was born and raised here, Vermilion. Went to school here, graduated from Vermilion High School in 1938. Because the war was in 1941, right? A lot of my friends went. The Women's Army Auxiliary Corps was formed in May of 1942. And they sent people out to what do you call them? Recruit. And I read about it and I went and joined in February in 43. I was a high-speed radio operator at Vint Hill Farms Station, Virginia, right outside of Washington, D.C., and I had a citation from the War Department Intelligence Division.
Okay. Now, as far as high-speed radio operator, what all did that entail?
I copied code, Morse code. I copied Morse code. We had two radio sets, one above the other, and what we couldn't get on one, we put on a dictaphone. Then we had to go to the translation room and copy it.
Now, were these codes or messages that were coming from the front, or were these?
Yes, all over. We copied code from all over the world and the United States and the ships at sea.
What kind of training did you have to go through?
I went through Midland Radio and Television Schools in Kansas City. I graduated from there. And also, I was sent to Camp Crowder, Missouri for additional training for 30 days in teletype machines and copying code from going across the letter code and additional code training so that I could get up to, well, I was up to the speed of 35 words a minute when I left the school. I was a second woman to go to work at the monitoring station.
Were there certain restrictions that you had to go through, like the common phrase now is, if I tell you this, I have to kill you, for example. Were there some classified or top secret things that you personally had to handle?
No, not till I was surveillance someplace else. Our code was code. What we copied that was what was plain language would be notes from newspapers or something coming in, and we ignored them. But we did sit on different codes all coming in at once. First, you would copy one sound, then you would go back and get on the tape and get another sound from the prisoners of war, and we worked hard on those. I can remember sitting there all night just trying to figure out which code was which and what. It was code. I had to go to the code room.
Now, in this code room, what would take place?
I don't know. I was never there.
Okay.
That's a separate group.
So you would take the message, you'd take it down as best you could, and then give it to the code room, and it was their problem from
there.
Yes,
right. And only one I really had trouble with was it wasn't Morse code as code. Ours was five-letter groups, space five-letter groups. On a piece of paper, and when it came in and just kept going and it looked funny, you just raised your hand. I did, and my sergeant came and got the paper and ran it to the code room. I believe, but I can't prove, that I was the first one to copy Japanese code on the Atlantic side.
Wow. What was that like when you realized it?
Well, was it just weird, and I had turned it whole thing or the record around thinking I was copying wrong, and then I went back to the original and I was all the same. So that's when I raised my hand and the sergeant came running and I got the paper. I didn't have anything to do with translating anything. And we did copy plain language from the newspapers, but we were taught never to believe anything you read in a newspaper on half of what you saw.
Okay. When you got this intelligence certificate, what kind of things were involved in getting that?
No, I don't know. It just came in the mail. I couldn't believe it.
Okay. And she's holding up one as Fern L. Marcotte acknowledges with appreciation, loyalty, and devotion to duty, serving with the Military Intelligence Division. Okay. So you did that for about 13 months, give or take?
As soon as I got out of school. Quick training. I went right down to Vint Hill Farms. They, from what is the name of that? Camp Crowder. From Camp Crowder, Missouri, there were 200 women to 200,000 men. And from there, when we went to school, we had posted armed guard around our barracks after the first night. And they split us. 100 went to Vint Hill Farms in Virginia, and the other ones went to California someplace. So I don't know where they went, and I never kept in touch with any of them. I left Vermilion by myself with another lady I never heard of again. She went in Cooks and Baker School, I think. And I was sent right out of basic training to radio school.
Mm-hmm. Is that something you had an option on?
We were told to put down what we thought we could do, and I put administrative, medical, or communications. Well, I passed the test for communication. Three of us left from our barracks.
I would like your recollections. There was a bit of a window between the time you graduated from high school and the time the United States got involved in the war. What was pre-war at that time, in that window? What was pre-war Vermilion like?
Well, we're just waiting for the 147th to leave. Most of us knew all the fellas in the 147th. Some of my, let's see, 38. I graduated in 38. So there were some of the young men out of my senior class that left before 41 into the service. And we'd see them in uniform. And then when the boys went into service in 41, they were always coming home on leave. And there was always somebody wanting you to come to dinner. I knew all of the fellas because I worked at the bakery. And I wrote to almost all of them. I had about 8 letters a night I used to write to. And I don't remember too much about it. So much I had to forget.
When you got the dinner invitations, would you usually go?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I knew all the ladies, too.
Okay.
See, I knew everybody in town. That's why when I was in the service, going to school in Kansas City, somebody came to see me, and it was an officer. I'm not an officer. And we were warned that if we went with an officer, we would be fined $65. That's more than I made a month. And this officer came and told me he wanted to talk to me. He knew me. He knew my family. He knew even my dad's middle name. I was so dumb, I didn't know what he was doing. But I was hesitant. I didn't want to go with him. He wanted me to go out to dinner. I said, I don't know you. I thought I knew everybody in Vermilion. I used the chief of police and a sheriff for my references when I went in. So everybody knew me, and I knew everybody else. But that man, I did not know, and I wasn't going to go with him. But he talked me into going around the corner to a little coffee shop and having coffee with him. So I did, and he told me all the things. And I confirmed what he told me because he knew what he was talking about. Then he walked me back to the hotel. I lived in the Aladdin Hotel in Kansas City on the 13th floor in room 1314 with 3 other ladies. He was going to come right with me. I said, you can't go with me. He said, I guess I can. I said, no, you can't. And I'm the one getting in trouble. He says, I outrank your commanding officer. So I said, well, but you're not getting on that elevator with me. No, you wouldn't get on the elevator. Okay, fine. I wrote and asked who he was. I asked my folks, they didn't know. And it took me years to figure out that he was somebody sent to interview me for this War Department.
So never was from Vermilion?
No, he never was from Vermilion. He was some stranger, sent out, knew all my whole record. A nice man, but I don't have any part of him. Mm-hmm.
So you're probably glad that you followed the procedure.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. When I got this thing, oh, I knew what he was doing. They never told me I was an intelligence. Mm-hmm. I knew we had strict regulations to go under Vint Hill Farms. You had to have a pass to get in the day you get your first gate, then you had to have another pass to get in the other gate where the working place was. And our barracks was our camp was a from the air would be a plantation. The big barn was our, where we worked. We had a silo where we stored our stuff. And then there was a big house where the captain lived, or the colonel, or whoever it was that was in charge of us. And then women were way down in a grove with four different barracks. We had our own mess hall and our own day room.
Where were you on December 7th of 41 when you found out that the Japanese had attacked?
I was home. And, of course, it was all big news in the town. And, of course, we worried. Warren was and Wayne, his brother, was in the 147th. Warren was not. He had, in 39, he joined the Navy. He was 19. And he was in South Pacific.
So plenty to worry about right there.
Yeah. Yeah, and Wayne was in this. Most of my friends were in the 147th Field Artillery that I went to dances with and so forth. And they all just left right after December 7th. They called them up. So we were left. The girls were left at home.
How exactly did you find out that that the attack had taken place? Were you listening to the radio? Did someone come to the door?
My dad was he listened to the radio, yes. And so my dad went to work for the shipyards in Vanport City, Washington. And my brother went into the Navy, my oldest brother. I'm the oldest, younger brother. He went into the Navy. He was also a radio. My dad was a signalman in the First World War. My brother was a radioman on an LST. So it's in the family, I guess.
Okay. That's quite a record of service, and I know that's something that you certainly are proud of.
Oh, yes. My husband was in the submarine service and down in Philippine Islands. His boat was tied up at Cavite, and when Pearl Harbor was bombed, they knew what was coming. They were going to be next, and about 2 days later, I think it was, two or three days later, they bombed the boat next to the boat my husband was on. It was a 500-pound bomb, and that's what I have in here. Warren used to tell it, but nobody would believe him here.
And do you have a letter or something, or a news article or something on that?
Yes. Okay. There's a magazine put out by the submarine veterans of World War II, and in there was this article, and it was exactly what my husband told us. And of course, it's written by somebody else because I couldn't get my husband to write anything. And that is exactly what Warren used to tell him. And of course, the men at the coffee shop would never believe anything he said because he'd get exaggerated.
Would you be willing to read a few paragraphs of this so I could just have this for our record in your own words, please?
Oh, please. Oh, you mean, well, why Warren had an earring?
Well, just five or six passages of that, if you'd like. Something that, if you'd like to jump at a point that you find particularly interesting.
Oh, and when the war was on, Warren was on the Sea Dragon, and part of the Asiatic fleet that was stationed in the Philippines. And in December 41, we were at a Cavite Navy yard for an overhaul. And on the same day Pearl Harbor was bombed, the Japanese wiped out all the airfields in the Philippines, thereby eliminating our air protection. On December 10th, 41, at 12 noon, the Navy yard was bombed. Three flights of 27, he said, 81 in all, flew over the Navy yard, dropping 500-pound bombs. We didn't have a gun that would touch them. They didn't even break formation. They completely destroyed the Navy yard and all the ships in the dry dock. Our Sea Dragon submarine was tied up to the dock. Our sister ship, U.S. Sea Lion, took a 500-pound down the after torpedo room hatch, sinking her. At that very instant, one of our officers and I were in the conning tower. This is this man, and not my husband. He was in the engine room. The officer was killed there by the shrapnel he sustained, and while this man was rushing down the ladder to the control room, and another concussion knocked another 14 feet down to the control room deck, and there were some knobs about 2 inches long on the railing that used to be at the pump room hatching. He fell into the one of the knobs sticking up, landing full force at the tip of his spine. And he lay down there senseless for a while, and then he heard a captain abandon ship. By the time he got picked up, picked himself up and managed to get topside and was starting down the dock, the captain was then telling everyone to get back on board. The salvage ship, the USS Widgeon, was tied up to their stern and had some effect in pulling them away from the sea lion. And he said, we caught a lot of shrapnel. The pressure hull wasn't ruptured. He says a lot of the deck was gone. Part of the superstructure had holes in it. But they managed to get over to Manila, where they were subdued by the Conopus. Subtender. That's a subtender, USS Conopus. And then after 3 days' work, all night long, preparing them to be seaworthy, they left undercover darkness, went to lie down in the bottom of the Manila Bay until it got dark. He says that's the reason was because the Japanese waited till daylight to attack. And then when they were ready to go to sea on the 13th of December, they went to Surabaya, Java, in the Netherlands, East Indies. And they passed Corregidor and started south, and they saw three Japanese destroyers patrolling the entrance to Manila Bay. The Corregidor is an army island fort on the entrance to Manila Bay. And then as they proceeded to dive, the Japanese gave us a taste of our own depth charging. After about 2 hours, the three destroyers finally left and we surfaced. Then we went into Surabaya, Java. Went into Dutch dry dock and they fixed us up the best way they could. So they had a rough time.
Did your husband have any other close calls in his service?
Oh, yeah. Well, he said he spent time down in the bottom of the ocean young man was sick, and the corpsman operated on him for appendicitis. And that's a movie. There's a movie on that. My husband wrote and told me he couldn't write about it, but he told me to read an article in a certain magazine. So I went, I think it was the Esquire magazine, and I can't find it. I must have it someplace, but I couldn't find it. And there was a story was in there.
Now you had to be very careful as far as letters and communication, not only to the soldiers, but from the soldiers back to you. Did you get a lot of mail
that was
censored?
I got a lot of mail that was censored, yes, I did. Particularly from, well, I had friends. I worked at the farmer's elevator and got to know truck drivers that came in, boys that were picked up eventually into the service. And I worked at the bakery and I knew all the young men that I went to school with and my friends, brothers. And I wrote about 8 letters a night. And, you know, I didn't keep any of those, but I did keep the one that came back missing in action. I never knew what happened to that young man.
That had to be very hard to get when you found out.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. He was such a nice boy. A boy, young man. And, of course, I wasn't immediate family or anything, so they weren't going to tell me what happened to him. But I always wondered what happened to him.
How did you meet your husband?
I've known my husband since we were wee babies.
And when did you realize that there was kind of a spark there?
Well, we were in the same group. We had group young men and women. I had a boyfriend that had been a friend of my dad and mother's boy for years. I think I went with him from the time I was 13 till I was 10 and 19, graduating high school, and he's still in high school. And then he ran away with the one girl that was dating my husband. they ran away because his folks didn't approve of her. So they left, he and his wife, they went to California, and then after Warren and I had been married and went to California, we met him and we were good friends again. Same, different partners.
Mm-hmm. Now, so, I've been to Morse's, well, a bunch of times since I've lived in town, and that's been over 10 years now. And I remember a newspaper article about brothers who found each other.
Yes, Warren and his brother found each other. Warren was stationed in Australia with his submarine. And he heard that the 147th was there. And he saw some on the street. So he went looking. And he got on a train and went back in someplace and found them. His brother and all his friends that were in the 147th, because Warren had been in the 147th before he went away.
They were quite handsome, if I remember the photos.
Oh, boy, they're both nice-looking boys. Wayne had red hair. I dated him for a while because he was a dancer and I loved to dance. But Warren and I were closer, I think. It's not that we ever dated, but like if I was downtown and he was downtown, he'd say, let's go have an ice cream, and we'd go get the ice cream. That isn't a date, really, but we were close.
When you were in Virginia, I mean, Vermilion, South Dakota, and Virginia, it's pretty easy to tell the two apart, certainly. Was that a good experience? Did you enjoy living in a different part of the country, and did you make a lot of friends?
I didn't know it was cold in Virginia, because they unloaded us, the 100 that went to Virginia. First thing they said, is there anybody here that knows how to make a fire in a coal stove? South Dakota, Minnesota, and Colorado. We cut coal detail, and we had to make fires in those four barracks and in the latrines where a hot water heater were. And we caught that duty till I blew up the stove.